Good morning. It's Monday, September the 20th, and this is The Drill. I'm Ron, your host and the only true conservative in the United States today, welcoming all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers. I'm the only true conservative in the United States today because I'm the only person that seems to know that the United States of America is the only world superpower, and I'm the only one that insists that we should start acting like it. So I'm going to offer the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare. Then we're going to pledge allegiance to the flag. Then we're going to sing the Star Spangled Banner. After that, I'm going to have some offerings from the book Polemics, also from the complete works of Thomas Jefferson, one of the editorials from the Hearst newspapers, and we'll sing America the Beautiful and more. All that when I come back. Thank you. And now for the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for September the 20th. Your obedience activates your faith. My child, the way that I will know that you love me is by your love to me and your obedience to my instructions. My commandments are not burdensome, for though your obedience, through your obedience, you will overcome the world. It is your faith that overcomes the world. What good is your faith if it is not accompanied by your actions? Without action, faith is dead. Your obedience demonstrates to me that you trust me and believe I know what is best for you and that you are honoring your commitment to follow me. If you want to receive my blessings, you must demonstrate that I am the Lord of your life. Your obedience in the testing ground will do that. Trust me with all your plans. Love me by keeping my word. Do not sin against me. And I will shower my blessings down upon you. And let's see, the prayer declaration is, Father, I am willing and obedient to your will. I present myself to obey you, Lord. Therefore, I am a slave of obedience leading to righteousness. I thank you that you made me righteous through your obedience. I will not obey unrighteousness. I will obey your truth. I will receive your blessing because I obey your commandments. And that was the Daily Declaration for Spiritual Warfare for September 16th. Thank you. And now the next chapter, I believe, is 32 from the book called Polemics by Christopher Snowden. And it's just chock full of great stuff. And 32 basically he's going into and debunking the idea that healthy food is more expensive than fast food. This is a deterministic idea by paternalists who want everybody to believe that the only reason people eat fast food is because it's cheaper than they're forced to, because it's cheaper, and so that's why they don't eat healthy food. So then we've got to find a way to screw around with making perhaps fast food more expensive with higher taxes, and thereby making healthy food more attractive in the process. So healthy food is expensive if you look at it in a certain way. That's the name of the chapter 32. The notion that it is expensive to eat healthily is widely held, despite being obviously wrong. A few weeks ago, I found myself filmed in a New Zealand supermarket searching for a healthy meal for four. The Kiwi equivalent of The One Show wanted me to show how much more expensive it is to cook a nutritious meal than to eat out in a well-known hamburger chain. In fact, I was able to buy all the ingredients for a good quality chicken stir fry for half the price it would have cost to buy four basic fast food meals. This seemed to come as a shock to the show's presenters and, I would guess, to a fair number of viewers. It is widely believed that burgers and fries are a cheaper alternative to wholesome, home-cooked dinners. Comparing the price of a fast food meal to the ingredients of a homemade dish is, to be perfectly candid, a bit of a cheat. What about the opportunity cost of preparing the meal? What about the financial cost of heating the oven or taking the car to the supermarket? Even if we had taken those costs into account, I suspect that the well-known hamburger chain would still have lost the battle of the bargains. But the experiment was not entirely fair. Comparing the price of, quote, healthy and, quote, unhealthy uncooked food in a supermarket, on the other hand, is extremely fair. Again, it is widely believed that the healthy stuff is more expensive, and this perception is strengthened by headlines such as, quote, healthy diet can cost three times that of junk food, unquote. Upon closer inspection, such claims are only tenable if you measure the cost of food in a particular way and if you ignore the word diet. The study that inspired the headline is published in PLO's one this week. It didn't look at the cost of a healthy meal, let alone a healthy diet. It looked at how much you would have to spend to get 1,000 calories from various food products. By this method, lettuce, one of which I bought yesterday for 49 pence, comes in at a whopping £16.45, whereas energy-dense food like donuts and jam cost less than a pound. Voila! Healthy food is more expensive than unhealthy food. To see the problem here, we need to ask how foods come to be defined as unhealthy in the first place. The study in question relies on a food standards agency test, which is used to decide what can and cannot be advertised on children's television. One of the key criteria is calorie content. The unhealthy foods have lots of energy in them, and this is measured by how many calories there are in 100 grams of the product. The more calories, the more likely it is to be placed on the naughty step. Calories are not unhealthy per se, of course, but the FSA's concern is that eating energy-dense food is more likely to lead to obesity than eating low-calorie food. That's all well and good, but it doesn't give the healthy food much chance of being cheap. Once you've decided that the price of food is dictated by how much of a calorific bang you get for your buck, low-calorie food becomes expensive almost by definition. By this measure, a lettuce would have to be sold in the shops for less than 2 pence for it to become cheaper than a sponge cake. Defining high-energy food as unhealthy and then defining cheapness as being, quote, food with lots of energy in it, unquote, is tautologous. You might as well declare heavy objects to be cheaper than light objects on the basis that they cost less per ounce. It would be true, but not very informative. Low-calorie foods are obviously not the best choice if you're in need of energy. Complaining that people would have to buy lots of them to get 1,000 calories is to turn their virtue into a vice. It would undoubtedly be expensive to meet your recommended daily calorie allowance by eating less lettuce, but it would also be horrible, if not physically impossible. It is precisely because lettuce is low in calories that we buy the awful, tasteless stuff. We then put it on a plate with other food to create a meal, and it is the cost of the meal that matters. Food prices have certainly risen in certain years by 8.6% in real terms since 2007, according to DEFRA, but they are still lower than at any time before 2002, and the price of fruit and vegetables has actually fallen in the last year. To claim, as the Independent has, that eating well has increasingly become the preserve of the rich borders on the histrionic. Your local supermarket will still sell you a cauliflower for 89 pence, a bag of potatoes for £1.50, and a kilo of rice for 40 pence. If people are not eating as healthily as the food standard agencies would like, it is not because we feel unable to get our day's calories from the vegetable aisle. It is because we can't make a tasty meal from it. So that is, again, I love it that he is debunking basically left-wing BS. One thing that he didn't, again, get into was the fact that all of this stuff has nothing to do, is they're trying to smuggle politics in through the back door here, through food under the guise of nutrition and nutrition for our kids, but basically smuggling in politics, trying to justify the heavy hand of paternalism rather than letting people make their own decisions. Thank you. I didn't do today, and I believe I didn't do Music Monday last week either, because I was having some issues where I was being warned by YouTube that my content was going to be possibly either edited or deleted because of copyright concerns, and which I found fascinating, because when I do Music Monday, I'm taking number one, clips off of Instagram. So the artists are offering this these particular clips free. There's an artist known as Armic, and he does flamenco guitar, and he offers up free samples from his latest work. And so as far as I'm concerned, that's a fair use thing that I'm going to put together and put it in my podcast. It's not for sale. I don't put all the stuff together and then try to sell it as a CD or something. So as far as I was concerned, basically free, fair use, but you know, arguing with YouTube is worthless. So for the time being, until I can get all that straightened out, I'm going to no more Music Monday. So I'll just put it like that. And so perhaps, though, what I may end up doing is like Funny Friday and start doing some jokes or something like that, just to add a little bit of variety to my podcast. But that's why you haven't heard Music Monday last week and this week, and for the time being, there's no more Music Monday. Thank you. A little blurb on beating determinism. And I had a segment last week about Instagram and determinism, and that the powers that be, or whoever they are, the people that are the news people, I guess, that are making accusations that Instagram/Facebook, because apparently Facebook owns Instagram, are is deterministic with its in regards to its relationship with young ladies, so 12, 13 year old girls and whatnot, that they are, Instagram is forcing young ladies to be depressed and to have negative views about themselves and their body, bad body images, and us, and suffer accordingly. Determinism only works with a have to. Okay, if you have convinced yourself that you have to have something, then and only then can you have a deterministic relationship with that thing. So in this particular case, for young girls that have decided they have to have Instagram, they absolutely have to have that, and or they have to have the favorable opinion of people, other people on Instagram, then Instagram becomes a power that can manipulate their moods and perhaps manipulate their behavior. Once somebody says, you know what, I don't have to have approval. I don't have to have Instagram. I don't have to have that. It's like a better example is tobacco. It's supposed to be deterministic that the only reason that people smoke is because people are forced to buy commercials that force them to brainwash them into smoking. But that only, again, it only works if there's a have to situation. If I say to myself, I've got to smoke something, so what am I going to smoke? Then you can make the case that tobacco companies have an undue influence over my life and are forcing me to use their products and forcing me to smoke cigarettes. But if I don't have to smoke, if I recognize that I don't have to smoke anything, then the deterministic influence of the tobacco companies cease to exist. And that's one of the ways you can, I guess, is a good test, too, of determinism, is asking yourself about the have to. Present a mental, not game, but anyways, a mind experiment. That's what words I was looking for. A mind experiment, and ask yourself, okay, with Instagram, for instance, do we have to have Instagram? No, then Instagram really has no power. The only way that Instagram would have any power is if I tell myself I have to have it, I have to be part of it, and I have to have the approval of other people that are on Instagram. So then this is the way you know that determinism is at play here, that this isn't a... That this is another fallacy among the many, many fallacies of the left. It looks good at first blush, right? And it's the idea of there's a particular name for the fallacy in Latin that I can't remember correctly, so I'm not going to say it. But it's the idea that if something happens before, one event takes place before another, that the one that took place before must have caused the other event. The cock crows, the sun rises, that doesn't mean that the cock caused the sun to rise. His crowing did not cause the sun to rise. So the same thing then applies here with other things, with other deterministic ideas. Is that you got to look at the cause and effect. Is there a solid cause and effect? And if not, then you're dealing with a fallacy with determinism and you should ignore it. Thank you, thank you. And now I'm going to be reading from the Complete Works of Thomas Jefferson. There's a section in the book in which it's filled with his letters that he wrote to various friends. And there's one guy, John Page, to whom he writes a lot of letters. And so this is a quick three-page letter and a little bit of commentary after I'm done reading it. So to John Page, Shadwell, January 20th, 1763. So this is happening well before the Declaration of Independence and the Revolutionary War. Dear Page, to tell you the plain truth, I have not a syllable to write to you about, for I do not conceive that anything can happen in my world which would give you a curse to know, or I either. All things here appear to me to trudge on in one and the same round. We rise in the morning that we may eat breakfast, dinner, and supper, and go to bed again that we may get up the next morning and do the same, so that you never saw two peas more alike than our yesterday and today. Under these circumstances, what would you have me say? Would you have me, would you that I should write nothing but truth? I tell you, I know nothing that is true. Or would you rather that I should write you a pack of lies? Why, unless they were more ingenious than I am able to invent, they would furnish you with little amusement. What can I do then? nothing, but ask you the news in your world. How have you done since I saw you? How did Nancy look at you when you danced with her at South Halls? Have you any glimmering of hope? How does R.B. do? Had I better stay here and do nothing, or go down and do less? Or, in other words, had I better stay here while I am here, or go down that I may have the pleasure of sailing up the river again in a full-rigged flat? Inclination tells me to go, receive my sentence, and be no longer in suspense. But reason says, if you go, and your attempt proves unsuccessful, you will be 10 times more wretched than ever. In my last to you, dated Fairfield, December 25th, I wrote to you of the losses I had sustained. In the present, I may mention one more, which is the loss of the whites of my eyes, in the room of which I have got reds, which gives me such exquisite pain that I have not attempted to read anything since a few days after Jack Walker went down, and God knows when I shall be able to do it. I have some thoughts of going to Petersburg, if the actors go there in May. If I do, I do not know, but I may keep on to Williamsburg, as the birth night will be here, or be near. I hear that Ben Harrison has been to Wilton. Let me know his success. Have you an inclination to travel, Page? Because if you have, I shall be glad of your company. For you must know that as soon as the Rebecca, the name I intend to give the vessel above mentioned, is completely finished, I intend to hoist sail and away. I shall visit particularly England, Holland, France, Spain, Italy, where I would buy me a good fiddle, and Egypt, and return through the British provinces to the northward home. This, to be sure, would take us 2 or 3 years, and if we should not both be cured of love in that time, I think the devil would be in it. After desiring you to remember me to acquaintances below, male and female, I subscribe myself, dear Page, your friend and servant. So, again, a letter to John Page. I don't know who John Page is, friend of his, obviously, but it was 1763, so a little over a decade before the Revolutionary War. What's interesting about the letter is that it shows that he speaks the way he writes and writes the way he speaks, that the Declaration of Independence wasn't where he sort of fancied up his language in order to, rise the occasion, so to speak, that the Declaration of Independence and other official documents that he's written is just the way he speaks in every day normal discourse. And you can get that from his letters. So that was, again, an excerpt of one of the letters that he wrote to John Page from the book, The Complete Works of Thomas Jefferson. And I wanted to remind everybody that I have for sale in the Kindle bookstore a companion book to this podcast. It's called The Drill, selling for $2.99, unless you have Kindle Unlimited, in which it is free. So I also want to remind everybody that the John and Ken Show is on 2 to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday on KFI AM 640. And a good material in terms of listening to them, in terms of getting a good idea of how it is that conservatives truly communicate. So until next time, I say to you, be smart, be beautiful, and remember that the left has no authority, no power, and they can't win.